Hello, folks, and welcome to the Yang Ifyong Show again. We have a repeat guest today, and is in the person of Dr. Fakunle. Dr. Fakunle, welcome to the Yang Ifyong Show.
Thank you, Yang, once again.
Dr. Fakunle is from CeSSA, which I hope CeSAHA, I hope I got the pronunciation right, which is the Center for Sustainable Access to Health in Africa. We've talked about his background before, but just to remind viewers and for people who are new, Dr. Fakunle has an MBBS and is a fellow of the West African College of Medicine Physicians in the Pediatrics section. There are a lot of acronyms after his name. He's a PMP. Dr. Fakunle, what is PMP?
It stands for Project Management. PMP, Project Management Professional.
Project Management Professional. So you are not just a physician, but a Project Management Professional is also a PMD. And is a FISQUA. We'll know what all these acronyms stand for when we talk more in detail about the topic for today. But just to run up on Dr. Fakunle's background, he's a health professional, a social entrepreneur, and he is very, very keen on things that will reform the health sector in Africa. So our topic today is on health sector reform in Africa. What do we have to put in place to make this happen? Welcome, Dr. Fakunle.
Thank you, Yang. Once again.
Okay, so let's start by understanding what is the health sector in Africa, and then we can drill into what needs to be reformed, because we need to know where we are before we talk about reform. So what's the status of the health sector in Africa right now?
Well, I think it's common knowledge that the health sector, well, the health system in Africa, It's what I can call comatose, if I use the medical term to describe it. It's really not very good, and it's affecting all facets of life in Africa. Of all the continents in the world, the healthcare system of African countries is the worst, and for a variety of reasons, which we don't really have to go into right now. But that is just the way it is. For example, Nigeria, out of about 194 World Health Organization member countries, our healthcare system is ranked, I think, 187 or so. So we are only better than just about few countries.
Sorry, that's, is that a mistake? Is that a mistake? You're saying out of 194, we are 180 something. Is that correct?
Yeah, that is correct. We are 187. So we are really very, very far behind. Yeah.
Okay. That is something that we need to work on. today we want to talk about reform. So we don't have bad situation.
Yeah, we need to reform the health sector.
And the organization, can you tell us a brief, give us some brief background about the organization before we go into what the brief one is about? What is CeSAHA set up to do?
Okay, CeSAHA stands for Center for Sustainable Access to Health in Africa. And it was set up by a couple of African health and development professionals. And the whole aim is to support the United Nations agenda on what we call universal health coverage. Universal health coverage refers to having the population, the entire population in the country, having access to essential health services they need, when they need it, without financial hardship. So the key words are universal, then health, then coverage.
Okay, so CeSAHA is set up to provide the means for people.
It's to support that, support that process and make it happen for us.
To make it happen all across Africa.
All across Africa.
Okay. Thanks a lot. So let's look at reform. Back to reform now. What are the things that we need to... Sorry about that.
Yes, sir.
What are the things that we need to put in place for reform to be a reality? What do we need to do to make reform to happen?
Okay, I think we need to understand what exactly is health sector reform. And the words are self-explanatory, but by definition, health sector reform refers to all activities whose primary purpose is to promote, restore, and maintain health. So everything you do, maybe you build hospitals, you train health workers, you look at the systems, everything that is related to making health work better is what I can call reform. Reform. So when you talk about reform, you are talking about moving the health sector from where it is today, which we are not really proud of, to where it should really be.
If I put it in a mathematical way, or in a simple term, using the what you told me earlier, so reform will be things that we need to put in place to move from, say, 184 to 100 or even 50, because nothing stops us from getting to number 50. Would that be correct?
Absolutely. Yeah, that would be correct. And if you say you want to carry out a reform, it must be purposeful. So it's something that has to be pre-planned, something that has to be carefully planned, that is also based on evidence. What has worked before? What can work? And then so it has to be purposeful. You can't just say you are going out of your house, you just enter your car. You must know where you are going even before you set out. So it has to be purposeful. And then the second aspect of health sector reform is that it must be transformational. You cannot continue to do things the way we are talking about the fact that the health system in Africa is very bad. So you have to take transformational steps. You cannot just continue to do things the way you used to do it. And the third one is that it must be sustainable. So it must be purposeful, it must be transformational, and then it must be sustainable. So all the efforts, all the reform activities have to be sustained. You need to hold the grounds so that the progress will be a continuous one. So those are the three elements that must be in place when you embark on a health sector reform.
Okay, thank you so much for putting that. So it must be something that sustainable is the word I really like. So it's not a one-off thing like painting the outside of a clinic or hiring 5 doctors and they don't have drugs to give to the patient. What are the elements of this reform? Are there more elements that we need to understand? What makes up the reform?
Okay, I think sometime in the year 2000, a scientist called Williams came up with what he called control knobs, and there are 5 of them. And these control knobs are things you need to establish, you need to set them, you need to adjust them to make health system reform achievable. And these 5 control knobs, I'm going to just mention all the 5s and then focus on one particular one that I think it's very necessary for you to achieve any meaningful effect. So the first one I will call the organizational knob.
Okay, I think I've been able to get the graphics for that organizational knob.
Okay. I is healthcare organized. Then the control knob, the regulatory knob. Okay. How is the healthcare regulated? We know that it is usually the responsibility of a government agency to regulate the health sector. So we need to understand the regulatory knob. Then the financing knob. How is healthcare financed? Is it by government? How is that carried out? That's also a very important control knob. Then the payment knob. The healthcare providers, how do they get paid for their services? How are they incentivized? And that would be the first one. Then the last one, which I think is the most important control knob, is some people call it persuasion knob. Or we can simply refer to it as consumer behavior knob, which has to do about change. We can say consumer behavior, perception knob. Of all these control knobs, I think the most important element is the last one, which has to do with change, the consumer behavior. And when we talk about consumer, we are actually talking about all the 3 levels of stakeholders that are involved with health sector. So looking from the policymakers to the healthcare providers, to the end benefit, to the end users, to the beneficiaries.
Okay, so for you're saying that for us to make change, we have to work on these knobs, the financing, payments, organization, regulation, and behavior. And you focus on behavior, or you say behavior is one of the most important knobs to play with. Is that correct?
Correct. We are talking about S sector reform. We are embarking on a major change process. While we recognize that not all changes lead to improvement, but unless you change, you cannot improve. And the improvement starts with the way you think. Are you thinking the same way, or are you ready to embark on the change process that starts with your thought processes? I think that is the most important regulatory knob. If you are really interested and serious about reforming the health sector, you need to start changing the way you think, the way you behave at all levels.
Okay, so let's drill down. Let's pick that one. I like the approach. So we have five knobs, but we've targeted one knob, and we see from the position that we are in that knob, the behavioral change knob, is really, really important. Would you care to share with us what we need to do, or what is the process of behavioral change that we need to understand, and not just understand, agree on, and implement for us to be able to have the proper health sector reforms in Nigeria and the rest of Africa? Could you share that with us?
Okay, sure, I can. You know, are you familiar with this saying that change is constant?
Yes, the only thing constant is change.
Is change, okay. So, and when we're not just talking about change, we need to start talking about meaningful change that makes a difference in people's lives. Okay, that reminds me of one popular saying that when the wind of change blows, what do you build? Do you build a wall to keep the change away, or do you build a windmill to take advantage of the change, of the wind of change? So for meaningful air sector reform to take place, we need to build a windmill so that we can take advantage of the positive change and use it to improve the quality of life of our people. Now, when you talk about changes can be quite challenging, can be quite difficult to implement, but it's inevitable. There are five steps in the typical change management process, and that starts with the first step will be as is, the status quo, the way things are today. Do we really know? Do we really understand the current situation? Have we been able to measure the enormity of the problem that we have? Because if you don't know where you are coming from, you may not go far. So that is the beginning of a change management process, for you to understand where you are, the status quo. And some people never leave that. They never leave that. They just want to stay where it is because that's the comfort zone. That is what they've always known. But for us to change, we need to move to the second level of change management, which is accepting, understanding and accepting that change is inevitable. That will be the second stage. The first stage is you acknowledge where you are. The second stage, you understand that for you to improve the quality of life of your people, now we are talking about healthcare, you need to accept and understand that change has come, change is inevitable, and we need to change. And that's a different kind of mindset.
Okay, so we have two steps now, as is, the way we are, and then you open your eyes and said, okay, I'm not going to be able to stop this change. So it's inevitable, it's going to happen. So what next when you've accepted, after acceptance, what next? Okay.
But you just don't only open your eyes, you also open your mind. Okay. So the third one is that you now start acquiring the skills and the knowledge that you need to make that change possible. That means you are now ready. You are now serious. And then when people look at you, they say, this man is really serious about this change journey that he has embarked on. And that is like you are planning, you are preparing yourself for that change that must happen. And that brings us to the first stage. So when you have acquired enough skills, you've acquired enough knowledge, you've prepared your mind, then you move to change, then you change. You actually change. And for the health sector, when we talk about change, one of the major challenges we have with the health system in Africa is this out-of-pocket payment. And that is why we are talking about universal health coverage as put forward by the United Nations, so that we need to put certain steps in place that will protect people financially from catastrophic healthcare expenditure. When people are sick, do they still have to pay out of pocket? Or have we established a prepayment mechanism that makes it possible for people to go to hospital, assess the healthcare they need, quality, appropriate quality healthcare they need, without financial hardship? That is a change.
Okay, so part of the change that you are emphasizing in is that how people will be able to ask when they are maybe physically incapacitated or they have accidents, or at the time that there are no more earning income, which is the time that they now need to spend a lot of money.
Absolutely. Even when you are earning income, okay, it can be quite, the cost of healthcare can be quite damaging to the financial health of a family. So that's why we talk about universal. It's something that applies to everybody, whether you are earning income or you are not. When you are sick, you must be able to have access to essential health services you need, where you need it, without financial hardship. That is a change. And when that change comes, it comes with all sorts of challenges, all sorts of difficulties that has to be overcome. Let me give you an example. That is what is happening in the United States today. There are 33 developed countries, and all of them except United States has what we call universal health coverage. So Obama started Obamacare, which is talking about affordable care for all the American citizens. But as you can see, they are struggling with it. And that is not surprising. So they are in the change. So they are in what I would call level four now. They are between level three and level four now. They are struggling with it. But eventually, if they stay with it, they will be able to go to level five.
Okay, so we're at level four. We've done the as is. We've accepted that change is inevitable, which is level two. We have acquired the skills and the knowledge needed for change.
Absolutely.
We are now in the midst of change.
We are changing.
So when we, after, you mentioned six, so this can be the end. One, two, three, four. Okay, we are level four.
We moved to
now.
Five.
So what is in five?
Five is now the new normal. The new normal. Change has now established a new standard, a new normal. So the normal is now the routine. Again, if you use the American example, they are struggling with Obamacare now. Okay, so if they're able to overcome those challenges, and they now go into what I would call a steady state that is now regarded as the normal stage. Normal, that's the way things are. That's routine. And that's stage five. And that is success.
Okay. Okay, so you've mentioned, after the turmoil of change, you now accept change as the new baseline. So what you are now doing is no more a change. It's now what everybody is used to.
Absolutely. It's now routine. It's now
routine. It's like learning a new language. And then when you start speaking it, you can't remember the time that you were struggling to know what bonsoir meant. So you just speak
absolutely.
It. Now. So is that the end? Because I've only counted five.
Then the 60, okay. Now you realize the benefits of change.
So now you get the benefits of all the change, that all the turmoil that you went through, you will now reap the fruit of your labors.
Yes, and when we again relate it to health sector reform, if you relate to universal health coverage, that is where you now have a population that is healthy and that is wealthy. a population that doesn't have to fear about going to the hospital, a population that has access to the good things of life. Okay, those are the benefits of a well-packaged health sector reform. A population whose children are not dying before the age of 5, a population whose mothers are delivering, having babies without any problem, a population whose children are virtually 100% of the children are vaccinated, a population that is resilient and able to meet any public health emergency. So when Ebola came knocking in West Africa, if you already have a health sector that is properly reformed, it wouldn't be any problem.
Okay, Dr. Fakunle, really taking us through the steps of change. I just want to do a quick summary of what we can look at and where we'll take from there. So if I make a mistake, please correct me. So you said the steps of change are as is, the status quo. This is where we are now. And then from there, we go to the point where we accept that change is inevitable. We stop running away from it.
Absolutely.
And decide what we are going to do next. So at this point, nothing we can do. The new people have taken over, so we'll do it. And step 3 is that we acquire the skills and knowledge. We build a very nice windmill that will allow us to harness the energy of the wind rather than the wall.
Absolutely.
So we acquire skills and knowledge that will serve us well in the new change system. And then we have the change itself.
Absolutely.
So we are now in change. And then you say from there, this is the part I really like. And I think this is one of people give up. They flip from 4 to 5, where there is no more tension, there is no more friction. And we have accepted that change is now the way things are. So we have accepted that we don't. Have you sent your child to vaccination? What you are discussing was, what vaccination center did you use? And we don't ask things like our mortal, what do you call that thing? Maternal mortality? When kids die?
Maternal. When mothers maternal. Die.
When mothers die. During,
when they are during childbirth. Mm.
Okay, so when the statistics come out, we are no more in the top 10.
No. Okay. In the bottom 10. We are no more in the bottom 10.
Okay, so change as a new normal. And I like 4, 5, 6. I know that I always like the easy part. So the most interesting part for me is when you have gone through all these steps and you now realize the benefits of change.
Of change.
So what you're saying is that we need to go through this step. We need to take an active part in it to be able to realize the benefits of the change. It's not just something that we wish that there will be a change and then the change happens. We have to work for it. That's what I'm hearing from you.
And you cannot jump from stage 1 to stage 3 or to stage 4. You have to follow the steps. And how long you stay in one particular phase is determined by your ability to embrace change, your level of ability to adapt. You know, in evolution, they say that it's not the strongest species that survives. It's the one that is able to adapt, that is able to embrace change,
that is not resisting the change. Yes, the one that adapts in that particular situation is the one that will move into the next generation.
Absolutely. So as Africans, as in Africa, if you don't change, we will become extinct.
Just like
the world, the world will not wait for us. And we have all the resources we have within that continent to have a meaningful health sector reform.
Okay, so we have all the local resources, and you're saying that we need to go through this level of change. I like the knob. I like the way we went through the knobs, all the things that we need to change in the positive direction to be able to have to reform the financing, how people are rewarded for providing healthcare. I think sometimes when we are talking about healthcare, we forget that people have to be rewarded for this because it's like any other service. So I'm happy that you mentioned that.
Absolutely.
We also focus a lot on the behavioral change. and you were kind enough to take us through these steps of behavioral change. Thank you so much. I know your time is very precious and you have other appointments. But before you go, can you tell us a little bit how your organization will drive this behavioral change? If you can just give us a quick summary of some of the things that you are putting in place to drive behavioral change for
I think we've already started. We have an organization. We are trying. We have a mission, which is well articulated. We have a vision, which is to have a healthy and wealthy Africa. And we also think that if we don't do it, nobody's going to do it for us. We have to take the lead as Africans. And we also know that when we're talking about change, we're talking about health sector reform. In the past, we used to think about resource gaps, that we don't have resources. But we now know that it's not just about resource gaps. It's about having the political will to have the right policy in place. If you have the political will, where there's a will, there will always be a way. So you have the political will, you have the delivery capability, and then I believe that resources will come. So we already told. So we are starting with what I think is the most important thing about creating the awareness, talking about what we need to do to move from A to B. And I think that's the most important. So we're already having that conversation. It is when we have been able to work on our minds, and then we can then move to actual implementation.
Okay, thank you so much, Dr. Fakunle, and I will pass this information on, and I really want our viewers, our listeners to come in and be part of this process of moving things forward. Folks out there, for you to get the full transcript of this interview and for more information about the organization, you can go to inyangfyong.com. You can also, for people who did not listen live, you can get all the information on this video and other interviews at youtube.com, inyangfyong.com. So thank you so much, Dr. Fakunle, for coming on board, and we will definitely call you back. I want to see more of you on this channel so that we can keep passing information about not just healthcare, but behavioral change and all the things that we need to do to move Africa from being one place that people always talk about. I only hear Africa in the news when they talk about donations, when people want to do good, when people don't want to feel depressed and they want to donate to somebody. And they say, oh, Africa, which, I mean, I don't see anything wrong with that, but that shouldn't be the only thing that we are known for.
Absolutely.
Thank
you, Mr. Ian, for your time. I'll talk to you later. Bye.
Okay.